worship services. And they're not necessarily just called fellowship services or preaching services or offering services or coffee services. These are worship services, which means that our first job and function is to worship God and to praise God. Lord willing, I'm going to talk to you about what it means to release heaven onto earth and how we do that. The environment of this house, God wants it to be alive and as electric as heaven is right now. And that's what we're going to put our heart to do. That's what we're going to put our focus to do. So everybody bow your heads. Let's pray and get ready. God, we thank you that today we can worship you in this place. We can glorify you in this place. We can magnify you in this place. And God, we're here to say that we love you and you are God. In Jesus' name, everybody shout amen. Come on, shout amen.
Your goodness never stops. Your because you are good. You are good to me. And I sing because you are good. And I dance because you are good.
Come on, don't stop. I want you to shout over me. I want you to shout over me. God is good. God is good. God, if you got to say it by faith, you say it by faith. God is good. Hallelujah. Oh, God is awesome in this place.
He's mine.
I need to hear you sometime, church, today. Awesome. Let the saints of God say, awesome. You are the saints of God, aren't you? Awesome. I want to hear you sing it today. Awesome. Oh, he doesn't care what you sound like. Awesome. He just wants to hear his kids today. Awesome. He wants to hear you say, I'm awesome. Awesome. He wants to hear you say, he's awesome. Awesome. Oh, what is he? Awesome. Oh, yes, he is. Awesome. Oh, in the darkest night, he's awesome. When I'm racked with pain in my body. Enough money to pay the bills. Awesome. Oh, what is God? Awesome. Oh, when everything doesn't look just right. Oh, he's awesome. He's awesome. Oh, my God is. Awesome. Oh, yes, he is. Yes, he is. Awesome. Oh, when you're in that dark place, he is. Awesome. When you feel like you just can't get out. Awesome. When you feel like you just can't. Oh, that sounds good. Well, come on. Oh, I love it. Yes, he loves it. Let's make a declaration today about your God. Oh, what is he? Oh, my God, my God, my God. Oh, yes, he is. What is he? One more time. He is awesome.
Ourselves out, God, today so you can fill us, Lord. Fill this temple with your glory, God.
You are always fighting for us, heaven's angels all around. My delight is found in knowing that you wear the victor's crown. You're my help and my defender. You're my Savior and my friend. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you. At the mention of your greatness, in your name I will bow down. In your presence fear is silent, for you wear the victor's crown. Let your glory fill this tent. Let your power overflow. By your grace I live and breathe to worship you.
Jesus, you have overcome. Go away.
but the grave could not contain, for you wear the victor's crown. Oh, church, he's overcome. Yes, he has.
Crown. You wear the victor's crown. He has overcome. He has overcome. Oh, and I rest in that. Because you see, because he overcome, I'm an overcomer. Because Jesus overcame, I'm an overcomer. I don't have to be defeated because I'm not defeated. Because he's the victor. He's the victor. He's made every provision for us to live the abundant life, to live a life far above and beyond what we can, the Bible says, what we can think and what we can comprehend. Because, and this is where Pastor is wanting us to get, is in the spirit. Not looking at this world that we see around us, but to see them as lost and dying, and that they are in need of a Savior, so that we're in the spirit and so that we can help them. That's what it's all about. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But today we're going to soak in the river. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God.
It's flowing today, folks.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God.
Sing, there is a river.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of our God.
Oh, he loves it.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of,
and I will rejoice,
and I will rejoice, and I will rejoice and be glad. Oh, tell me what you're gonna do, and I will rejoice. I will rejoice and be glad.
Oh, there is a fountain. There is a fountain. Come on, girls, help me out.
There is a fountain, and it's filled with blood, and it flows from Emmanuel's veins.
Here's what Jesus will do.
And he came and he healed.
refreshed me, and he came, and he washed it all, washed it all away. And I will rejoice, and I will rejoice, and be glad. I will rejoice, and I will rejoice, and I will rejoice, and be glad.
There is a fountain. Let's sing that one again.
There is a fountain, and it's filled with blood, and it flows from Emmanuel's veins.
What will it do?
And it came, and it healed me, and it came, and it refreshed me, and it came on a... Oh, yes, and I will rejoice.
There's problems out there. we have a reason in here to be excited. We have what the world is looking for. We have the answer. Why wouldn't we want to rejoice? Why wouldn't we want to praise a God who is so full of love, compassion, and mercy, who can break every chain in this house today? Chains of addiction, chains of hate, chains of lust, chains of pride. In the name of Jesus, we break every chain in this house, and we cry out to you, and we will rejoice, Lord, because we are free. Who the Son sets free is free indeed, Lord. And we are free in this house. Declare His praise this morning. Don't let the rocks cry out. Praise Him this morning. He deserves your praise. He deserves your praise. All of our praise that we have within us. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We praise your holy name. Thank you, Lord. You are good, Lord. You are good all the time. All the time. Hallelujah.
Begin to lift your voice and just pray. Really, I want you to lift your voice, especially men. Come on, guys. Really, just lift your voice and begin to pray. You can pray in the spirit. Come on, just lift your voice and begin to pray. Come on, pray for our nation. Pray for your family. Pray for our city. Come on. Lift your voice. Pray for your church. Pray for your family. The world is in need of somebody to pray for them. Lift your voice. Up in the balcony, lift your voice. Everybody in the church, stretch your hands out to the people in this section right here. Right here. Y'all look like you need prayer. God, we just declare goodness and righteousness and power, the very voice of God, to drift over the lives of every person in this section right here. And we just pray that the Holy Spirit fill, empower, and grace their homes, their jobs, every part of their life, in Jesus' name. God. Share, you know, just when you share God's love with someone, you know, it's find somebody and just, you know, hug their neck, say hello to them, whatever. But also do this, just speak some good things. Speak life and treasure. Speak into the treasure. We have a treasure in an earthen vessel. And sometimes you got to look pretty deep to find someone's treasure, but it's in there, all right? Speak to that treasure today. Say something good about someone. Say something good to someone. And let God's love and let His grace flow through you today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. So we're in the first service at 9:10, those intercessors were just getting entirely too loud. Sorry. I had, amen, God, I needed amen. I had a dream. I mean, this actually was before we started the church, probably in the 1980s. And I had a dream that I was sitting on a church platform with my father. And in that dream, and I thought about it really, I thought about that dream. And in that dream, I was sitting there with my father. I remember addressing the congregation and saying, "You want to know why the power and the presence of God rests here?" And I pointed up to my left and behind, see that window that's glass? It was just like that. That's why we built that prayer room up there for this very purpose. And I remember pointing that in that dream, I pointed to that prayer. I said, because there's people right there, right now, praying for us. So that's why we put that prayer room up there. And I was so happy, because I think this is the first time we've ever been drowned out by the, we weren't drowned out, but I mean, We could hear those intercessors up there. And I mean, it was glorious. It was glorious. We're right now, and I want to address the congregation in this. Right now, we're in a season where God's calling us to pray. Now you say, well, shouldn't we be praying all the time? Yes, absolutely. We should be doing a lot of things all the time. But then there's just certain things that God brings out of the buffet, and He puts it as the main course. And right now, the main course of our life, your life, my life in this church, anyone that's involved here, really needs to be about prayer. And so there are just seasons, and right now God's wanting to unlock something, and I don't know what that is, but I know in my heart God's wanting to unlock something in and over our church that can only be unlocked through prayer. And some of that I'll talk about in a little while. You may have noticed when you come in, I wanted to make an announcement too, and Bryce is going to come up and share a couple of things that's happening here at the church. We did not have the words on the screens for you because we had computer malfunction. And I'm not sure exactly what's going on, but the things that we use, the programs we use all the time, just turn a computer on. Well, it just decided it was going to act up today. So that's why we didn't have the words there, but that's okay. and you may have noticed, like, Kyle's not here today. And there's a transition right now in our worship. I've been working with Kyle and Jessica for 2 years. And in the last 3 or 4 months, we've been working with them to get them in a location after the conversations we had, in a place that they could thrive, and, you know, a place where they could just do the next phase of what God's calling them to do. And so this week was the week, and it just kind of happened quickly. But this was the week when that transition happened. So we're real happy for Kyle and Jessica. We thank God for their ministry here and what they've done for 2 years. And feel like that our worship team, amen. And we feel like our worship team has really benefited because of that, and has helped them step up their game. And we would not have been able to have had the worship we had today had it not been for the last 2 years. We thank God for that. And it's really positive. It's really wonderful. There's no backstory. There's no secret story. It's just, you know, there's times and seasons, and there's times when God moves you here. There's times when God moves you away. And then there's people like me that move in, just stay. They just don't go anywhere. It's just like stuck here. So, you know, there's permanency in some positions, and then there is non-permanency in other positions, and that is just the time where we're going to transition. Well, I'm real excited about it, in fact, and just enjoy, you know, over 24 years, I enjoy these times of transitions, frankly, though it presents challenges. I've always found that in those challenges, even sometimes you just got to fight a new enemy. You know what I'm saying? Challenges bring new enemies. But you know what? Sometimes it's refreshing. Just give me a new devil. I've met this one before, so I'm going to enjoy whooping up on that devil. So whatever new challenges come your way, it's all good. All right? It's all God. And anyway, that's what's happening if you're wondering. So our worship team right now, we don't feel like the elders, as we've prayed about it, we're in no rush at all to get a quote-unquote leader. We're just going to let our worship team be a team, and they're going to bring us worship as a team. And the most important thing about worship is not up here anyways, because I've been in churches before where worship is not nearly as, say, talented as other churches or as quote unquote musically good. What makes a great worship time is great worshipers. That's what makes a great worship time. So here's what I'm asking you to do in this season, this new season we're in, where we don't have any one particular leader, but we've got this team up here, and I can speak for all of them, and I can tell you what they're asking. I feel like this is God asking us. God's asking you to become a worshiper. Yeah. Now, I don't know how you worshiped. I can't see everybody. I'm over here, you know, and all the people up around the front, they block my view. But you got to ask yourself, did you worship or did you spectate? And if you're generally a spectator, you just kind of, you know, sit there and hang out and look at your watch and, you know, watch everybody else. I'm going to ask you to learn to do something different, to engage yourself in worship, especially the men, especially the men. And I know you can't dance, and I know you have no rhythm, and I know you can't sing. But you know what? It shouldn't ever stop you from learning how to speak the language of heaven. There is a language in heaven, and this is going to be the topic of the teaching today. There is a language spoken in heaven that is the language of worship. It is the language that engages the presence of God. And you got to learn to speak that language. If you're not speaking the language of praise, if you're not speaking the language of worship, you are not engaging the presence of God. Because it's impossible to engage the presence of God apart from worship. Impossible. Because God, Psalm 22, abides in the praises of his people. He doesn't abide in it. He abides in your praise. And so if you don't learn how to engage God in praise, not just in church, but like every day of your life, praising him, worshiping him, that attitude of the heart, if you don't learn to engage the presence of God that way, you're not engaging the presence of God. And if you're not engaging the presence of God, you're missing out on the whole fun of this thing. Good grief, God didn't save you just so you go to heaven. God saved you so you could taste heaven on earth. God saved us and put us together so we could release heaven on earth, literally to bring heaven, the atmosphere of heaven into your home. How many people believe that you can bring the atmosphere of heaven into your home? How many people know your home needs a little more heaven and a little less hell? Absolutely. This earth and the rain, the God of this world is the devil. Okay, the Bible's clear on that. So if you ain't got heaven in your home, you got hell in your home. You know, you don't get this middle ground. No. So you got to engage the presence of God. Learn to speak the language of heaven. And when that happens, you literally bring heaven down to earth. There is an atmosphere. Have you ever walked in someone's home and they've been fighting and you walk in and it's not like anything they've said, but you can feel it? Sure you can. I'm going to tell you, you can also walk in someone's home that's been praying, and it's like, when you walk into a home that has heaven in it, man, it's, you feel like you've been there your whole life. It's so comfortable. You feel like you just want to sit and, oh, it's so peaceful. This is real, friends. This is reality. The spirit world is reality. And so God has saved us to learn how we can navigate in the spirit realm and then be able to bring heaven to earth. That's awesome. That's awesome. And so that's going to kind of be the topic today. And God gave me this word about 2 weeks ago, and I was wanting to preach it, and I thought, oh, shucks, it's pastor appreciation. I can't do that. I'll do it next week. And then I thought, ah, it's men conference. I can't do it there. So I've been kind of like sitting on this thing. It's just been brewing in my heart for a couple of weeks now. And this morning is the time to talk about the language of heaven and how to release heaven into your environment. That's good news. And that's good. You can do it too. You are totally made for that, totally equipped for it. So that's what's coming up. But first, we got announcements. We're going to receive our offering, that kind of thing. And Bryce, come up here and let the church know what's going on.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Now, we have something cool coming up on November the 28th. So I want you help me do this. OH. Michigan. Well, they don't even have anything to say. So on November the 28th, we're going to be having the Ohio State versus Michigan game, basically the Ohio State defeats Michigan game. And we're just asking that everyone will bring some food, bring a pot of chili, bring some chips, bring some soda, and bring a good attitude to bring heaven for Michigan, because they're going to need it. After that. So anyways, that's coming up on November the 28th. And then if I can get the youth group, they typically sit over there. Everyone stand up, because we don't have video announcements today. And everyone over there, if you're in the youth group, stand up. You make me stand up here and be awkward. Just wave at everyone. Just say hi. All right, everyone say hi back to them. Give them a wave. All right, now tell them to sit down. All right, so we have youth tonight at 5:30. And so that's grades 7 through 12. And that we have that at the same time that we have our evening service. So the adults meet over here. The youth meets over there. We have a good time. We hang out and have worship. And so that's this evening. And then the last thing I want to share with you is that next Sunday, our whole youth group is going to go to a church in Pickerington. We're going to leave right after church. And we're going to go grab lunch together. So they'll need to just bring some money for lunch. And then we have a few other churches that we connect with and hang out with. And we're just going to get together and worship. And someone will be preaching. And it'll be an awesome time. And that'll be up in Pickerington. So we're going to all leave together next Sunday. Now, one thing I want to remind everyone is that on opendoorohio.com, if you click on calendar, I keep that up to date. Every Monday, I go on there and I update any dates that are going on. We do that in staff meetings. So if you're ever not sure, you need to know what's happening and when it's happening, you can head to our website at opendoorohio.com and click on calendar. Now, I'm going to go ahead and transition here into offering time. And I want to do something a little bit different today. I want to just pray with you. I want to activate something inside of you because, you know, when it comes to offering time, when it comes to giving, there's a scripture that I think makes a lot of sense that comes to giving in general. And listen with me. In Proverbs 3:27, it says this: "Do not withhold good from those whom it is due when it is your power to do it." Now, this past week I was in Texas while I'm there, you know, you always run into people and a lot of strangers. And you know what? I just made it a point to compliment people who I knew were really busy and really frustrated for no other reason than the point that I could tell they were frustrated. I could tell they were busy. And here's what, let me read this again. Do not withhold good from those whom it is due when it is your power to do it. And I think one of the biggest things that we forget is who we are. One of the biggest things we forget is who we carry in us every single place that we go and everywhere that we go. You have the power, not just to preach Jesus' name, because a lot of times when you say the name of Jesus, he's not very well received. But if you're pretty positive and kind and you build a rapport and trust with people, he becomes a lot more attractive to them. And so I think that it's due time for us to really get and to really understand that we have more power than we realize. We have more in us and what we really understand. And so what I'd like to do, and you can prepare your offering, but before I have you stand up, You can make checks out to Open Door, and there are slips of paper in front of you if you need to put anything inside of an envelope. But the same is true whenever it comes to give, is that we forget the power of giving. We forget the power of being able to share our finances and our resources, not only with other people, but with the kingdom of God. You know, a lot of times I used to have a real hard time thinking about church, because I would think, oh, well, we just come in here every Sunday and we kind of get refreshed or we get filled and then we go out and do our thing. And I felt like, well, we should be doing, you know, we should be doing more. And God kind of began to work on my heart, because I had a wrong mindset when it came to being able to give to my church. Because how many of you can know that your life has been changed by being here? That your life has been renewed, that you've been able to bring friends or bring family here, and you may not have seen all the change, but they had change in their lives. And part of your giving, but every single time you give, every single time that you're faithful and you offer your offering to God, you are making that happen. You are making a place possible for people to receive salvation. They don't only receive it here, okay? We're supposed to be equipped here so that we can do it out at our jobs and with our families. But part of what you give brings salvation to people's lives. And we forget that what you give. So I want to encourage you this morning, don't withhold the good that's in you. Don't withhold the power that you have to see God move in lives. So if you would, stand up with me, and ushers, you can prepare yourselves to get ready. I just want to pray with you, and I want to switch. Everyone do this with me. Can you snap your finger? Okay, so let's do this on three. Ready? One, two, three. All right, that's exactly what I want to see happen right now in your mind or in your spirit. Sometimes, do you ever just get like a knot in your stomach where you can just feel God or something? I mean, I know it's kind of maybe an odd thing to say. Sometimes I just feel like we need to understand who we are and the power that's inside of you. So if you would, bow your head with me, hold your offering in your hand. God, we just declare a blessing over our seed today. God, we pray that you would do something supernatural in our lives, God, that as we begin to press forward in prayer, God, as we begin to move forward in this church and seek you, God, that we would understand that we carry inside of us the power to do good in your name and the power to see salvations happen in this church with our finances and the things that we give, God, that you see our hearts, that you never ask us to give more than what we're able to, but that you always ask us to give exactly what you would have us to. And God, we ask that right now you would just shift something inside of our mind, that you would just turn a light on, that you would allow us to see the power that's in us and the good that's in us, Father, that we may sow goodness in the lives of our friends and in the lives of our family and in the lives of strangers that we meet, God, that they may reap a harvest, that your kingdom may flourish, that your kingdom may be strong and may be alive, and it may be moved from heaven to earth through us. God, let us never underestimate your power to do good through us. Let us never forget your power to do something amazing and mighty through the hands that you've given us. We pray that you bless this seed and that you honor what we're given, and that we would see it return, Father, in joy, in love, financially, in relationships, God, in every measurable way, that we would be filled with the power of the Holy Spirit for your name and for your kingdom. Amen? Amen. Why don't you clap with me and you can be seated. Let's just give praise to God. That's awesome. All right.
Okay. I want you to look at some scriptures with me, and I'll have you stand up in a minute. But first, let me get some scripture out to you. So if you have your Bible with you, first I want you to turn. First, let's do this. Let's do this. Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Okay? Can you do that? Let's say it. Ready? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Now, in that little prayer is the answer to a very deep question. The question from the disciples was, teach us how to pray. That's it. That's all Jesus gave them. That's it. And so we could dissect that, but there's only one part that really interests me today in regard to what I want to say to you. And it's the part that says, your will on earth as it is in heaven. Your will on earth as it is in heaven. Can you say that with me? Your will on earth as it is in heaven. All right, so if we were going to draw that out, if we were going to map this out as an illustration, I'd probably do it like this. That here's heaven, okay, and down here is earth. And God's will, he is praying, would be done on earth like it is in heaven. So we might say it like this. How do we get heaven to earth? Well, you know, you can come up with a lot of answers, but there's a real simple one. Jesus was telling us to pray. So evidently, there is something about a human being speaking out that releases heaven onto earth. Think about that. There is something about a human being speaking out that brings heaven down to earth. I was talking to our worship team yesterday, and I said, you know, guys, your job is not to have good songs. Your job is to create an environment. Your job is to help create a conversation. Your job is to create a language of heaven in this place that literally brings the atmosphere of heaven to earth. That's an amazing phenomenon, especially in light of what Jesus said in John 6:63. In John 6:63, he said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Now, that's interesting, isn't it? The words that I speak unto you, Jesus said, those are spirit and they are life. That's in John chapter 6, verse 63. So, somehow, Jesus was able to, with his tongue, with his speech, he was able to release life and spirit. Oh. He was able to engage his vocal cords, move his tongue, speak in Aramaic, but somehow the words came out of his mouth. They were full of spirit. So when they reached somebody's ears, it was boom. And it was life. When someone was dead or somebody upset, the word that he spoke was like boom, boom. And it would release something. And in the chapter, Jesus tells us the real key to doing that. In John chapter 6, he says, I don't say anything that I haven't heard my Father say. Jesus, I mean, no disrespect, had big ears. And he had his ears and his eyes in heaven. Because in John chapter 6, he says two things. I only say what I hear in heaven. I only do what I see my Father do. So what he was saying was this. I am seeing and hearing things in heaven. And as I see and hear, I speak. And when I speak, the words that come out, I am speaking a language, not an earthly language. It doesn't mean if it's Aramaic or Greek or English. It doesn't matter what that earthly language is. But there is a language. There is something that I'm hearing in heaven, seeing in heaven. And when I say those things, it comes out as spirit and life. Oh, boom! And it just broke people open. I mean, it unbound people that were addicted. Heaven came to earth. 2,000 years ago, when this carpenter walked around Israel, heaven was coming to earth. And demons could not withstand him. And disease could not withstand him. And waves could not withstand him. And seas could not withstand him. Because he was able to release a sound, release a voice, release a language, because he had gone into the presence of God in heaven, so to speak. And this is not to say that we have to leave earth to do it. No, heaven is here and now. It's in the heart. It's in the secret place. Jesus was so accustomed to the secret place and the presence of his Father that he negotiated heaven and then brought that down to earth. And when he spoke and when he acted, he was releasing heaven on earth. And he did it using only the tools available to you and I. He did it as a mortal. He did it as a man. He did it as a human being. He took off his robes of divinity and he put on mortality and he ministered as a human being. Back in Psalm 24, David was a weird human being. I mean, this guy would go out and kill a few hundred and wash the blood off of his hands and then go write a poem about it. David was seeing things that he wasn't supposed to see. David heard things he wasn't supposed to hear. David understood that his praise and his worship caught him up into another world, and it was in that world that he was seeing and hearing things that he didn't even know what he was seeing and hearing. I'm convinced of it. And David was almost like transported into another world. He was like, beam me up, Scotty. And he wrote of things he saw and heard in an Old Testament setting when nobody really understood it. I want you to think about David for just a minute. Consider David. In the law, it says that only the high priest could come before the Ark of the Covenant. There were instances where people would touch the Ark of the Covenant and die. In the law, it said it had to be hid in the Holy of Holies. David did something unusual. He took the Ark of the Covenant and he set it in the middle of Zion and he just put a tent around it. And only in the Holy of Holies was the ark supposed to rest. And only the high priest was supposed to enter. But here's what David did. David said, you know, I think I'm feeling something here. And he made just a single tent. And then he got worshipers all around the Ark of the Covenant. And 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, they just worshiped. I mean, they would do their eight-hour shift, and the next guy would clock in. They'd walk out, and the next group would take over. Because here's what David found, that God ultimately rests not behind a curtain. God ultimately resides in the midst of praise. In Psalm 22, that's why David wrote, God abides in the praises of His people. Why? Because He saw the Ark of the Covenant and the glory of God rested upon it, and it wasn't in the Holy of Holies, and it wasn't visited just once a year by a high priest every day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. God abided in the praises of the people that were worshiping. And David thought, wow, this is amazing. They're not dying. Can you imagine the first worship team he sent in there? Okay, guys, that ain't never been done before, and everybody else touched this thing. They looked at it, and they died. So, write your wills. Get prepared. You're going to try this. And it worked. And David began to understand concepts that were really in another season, in a future world. But David understood them because he understood the language of heaven. David also wrote this. David was a strange man. David understood things that people in his age did not understand in Psalm 24. In Psalm 24, David said, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." Oh, who's the King of glory? He's the Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. Well, what in the world was he talking about? What are these gates? Someone might say gates. Well, gates and doors. Were those the gates and the doors of the city? No, because they didn't have heads. And you can't look at a wooden gate and say, "Lift up your head," and the gates say, "Okay." But you can look at a human being. You see, when David said, "Lift up your head, O you gates, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in," he was talking about a human being who can literally become a gate and a door to heaven. That you can lift up your head, lift up your head, look up, look up, look up, look up, look up. Don't look down, look up, look up. But those people, don't look up, look up. But this guy, he said, "Look up over the devil's attack. Look up." David saw that when you look up, there's something about being able to look into heaven, gaze into heaven, experience heaven. And David saw, oh my goodness, we're like gates. We're like doors. We are like portals from heaven to earth. We're like the gate of heaven. We are like the doors of eternity. And a human being has the ability, literally, to be a gate and a door and say, "Woo! You want to see heaven?" That you speak out what you say can literally bring heaven, the environment of heaven in your workplace. But yet you gotta know how to do it. You gotta lift up your head. You gotta get tapped in. Worst thing we do is we get complaining like everybody else complains. We get all negative like everybody else gets negative. We don't lift up our heads, we put our heads down. So the good news is you know these gates and doors. We have the ability. I mean, how did David know all this? In Psalm 141, verse 3 and 4, he says, "Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth." Woo! There's your theme verse right there for today, ladies and gentlemen. Set a guard over my mouth. Why are the words so important? Why did Jesus say, "By your words you'll be judged, by your words you'll be condemned"? I mean, you'll be judged by every idle word that falls out of your mouth. Because your language, your words, are literally spirit and life. There is some spirit in your words. The only question is, what kind? What you speak, what you say. Psalm 141, verses 3 and 4 says, "Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Keep watch over the door of my lips. Do not incline my heart to any evil thing, to practice wicked works with men with work of iniquity, Do not let me eat of their delicacies. You see this? Set a guard over my mouth, the door of my lips, and do not incline my heart to evil things. All right, now this is going to start coming together. Because he has mentioned something now that has not been mentioned before, and that is the heart. So we see that there are these things now involved. Number one, heaven. Number two, our hearts. Number three, our words. Heaven to the heart to my mouth. From heaven through my heart through my mouth. Heaven comes to earth through a human being. A revelation from heaven through a pure and dedicated heart and through words then that are spirit and life. And when those three steps happen, they align literally the environments of earth become changed. The church was always meant to be spiritual. When God created Adam and Eve in the garden, they were spiritual. They were spiritual. The church is always meant to be spiritual. And the biggest danger we have in the church in America is that we stop being spiritual and we just become very natural. You know, we give motivational speeches, we have nice music, and we have a nice little club, and we have events, and everybody gets together. Listen, if you want that, you can go to the Elks, and the drinks are cheaper. You can go to AmVets. You can go to the Kiwanis Club. And even though all those things are a part of having a church, even, you know, having a High State Michigan game, all of those, listen, the bottom line is this, though. The most important thing is this. You and I are spiritual entities having physical experiences. And as a spiritual entity, it is your privilege, your right, and your responsibility as mine to be able to release heaven on earth. See, Jesus saved you so you could be a part of this bringing heaven to earth movement. 2,000 years ago, a movement started on earth. And that movement was to bring more of heaven onto earth. And for 2,000 years, the church has advanced bringing heaven to earth. And the Bible tells us that one day, so much heaven is going to be on earth that Satan literally will be cast out of the spirit realm and literally, physically be the embodiment of a human being on earth. The last days is not the sign of the church getting weaker. The last days is the story of a church that corners the devil and he's like a dirty rat in the corner and he comes out fighting. But he's going to lose. He's going to lose to a spiritual church. A church without spot or wrinkle. A group of people that know how to flow in and out of heaven. This is our right. It's our privilege and our responsibility. But it's not easy. You got to learn this. Go to the book of Revelation chapter 4. In the book of Revelation chapter 4, John goes to heaven. More accurately, he is invited to heaven. In chapter 4, he begins to witness what is going on in heaven. Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, it says, "After these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. The voice said to me, like a trumpet, he said, 'Come on up here, and I'm going to show you some things.'" And so, John literally was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, the next verse, and on that Lord's day in the Spirit, he was able to pass through a door until consciously he was looking at heaven. There's many things that go on there, and I'm going to take all the time to show you the living creatures and all that. But here's the most important things, starting with verse 8. "The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes all around and within, and they do not rest day or night, saying," it didn't say they were singing, it says they were saying, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for the last 2,000 years, from eternity past to eternity present, they are standing before the throne of God in heaven saying, "Holy, holy, holy." So, when your mind is in heaven and you become a door, guess what your language is? Holy, holy, holy. And then they said, "Lord God Almighty." He's the Lord. He is God. He is Almighty. So when you go to heaven, what's your language saying? Well, He's the Lord. And He's God. And He's Almighty. You need to talk more about God than you talk about your problems. That is your problem. You have become an expert on diabetes. Whatever else is infecting your body, you've spent hours on the internet Googling your disease, and it's become your special friend. I challenge you to learn more about God than you have your own diseases. Because He is God Almighty, who was and is to come. You go to heaven and you hear that, you get that revelation, you're like, "Woo, He is, and He was, and He is to come. What do I got to be afraid about? God's in my tomorrow." I'm telling you, there's a language that comes out of heaven that's spirit and life that breathes into the atmosphere. I can feel it right now. As I'm talking to you, you feel it. Whenever those living creatures give glory and honor and thanks, glory and honor and thanks, glory and honor and thanks. Whenever those living creatures give glory and honor and thanks, you go to heaven long enough and you get used to the environment of heaven. You know, have you ever been somewhere and you've been there so long, you know, you go back and forth, you get used to it. You get used to the environment in heaven, your language is going to be glory and honor and thanks. Glory and honor and thanks. Every time someone talks to you, give Him glory, give Him honor, and give Him thanks. Every time someone says they've got a problem, give Him glory, give Him honor, and give Him thanks. Every time somebody says something mean about you, you just open up your mouth and give Him glory and give Him honor and give Him thanks. Because you're releasing heaven on earth. The 24 elders fell down before Him who sit upon the throne, and they worship Him who lives forever and ever. And they cast their crowns down before Him and they said, "You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, honor, and power. Glory, honor, and power, for You created all things, and by Your will, they all exist that God created." Doesn't matter good or bad or indifferent, it's all under God's hand. Doesn't matter who raises up or who's put down, it's all part of God's plan. It doesn't matter what happens around us, above us, behind us, we know this. We've been to heaven. We've spent time in the glory land. We've spent time where David spent time. We've tread upon those very places where John the Revelator tread. We've come boldly before the throne of God. We've been in His presence. We've found Him in the secret place, and He has found us there. And it's there that we have communed. It's there that we have heard. It's there that we have seen. It's there that our opinions get adjusted. Quit watching CNN, Fox News, and MSNBC. To find your opinion about the world. There's something much more accurate, something much better, and it's finding your opinion in the secret place, in the counsels of Almighty God. Why in the world don't we live there? Why in God's name are we wasting our lives trying to be in everything else's presence and everybody else's but His? Doesn't make sense, does it? Doesn't make sense to you sitting here, because today you're in the environment of heaven. It all makes sense to you. The challenge is now for you to live in that environment, to walk in that environment as Jesus did. All right. We have got to learn how to have what I'm going to call glory events. That sounds like a Pentecostal camp meeting, doesn't it? It's a glory event. Oh, shabba-da-ba-da. Amen. We got to have glory events. I read a book one time called Fierce Conversation. It's a great book. I love what this woman said. She talked about relationships, and she said, what are relationships? What makes a relationship? What defines a relationship? What creates a relationship? And here was her answer, and I agree with her totally. She said, a relationship is nothing more than a series of conversations. How many of you remember when you first met the person that you're married to and you fell in love with? You just had a series of conversations. You just had these series of conversations. Now, Nikki and I started dating back in the day of long distance. When my mom and dad got the bill, so I was on the road. I was calling third party. Oh, yeah. Baby, I was in love. You talk about wanting to hear heaven's voice, I'd call her. I remember her. My bill was about like 6 weeks of my salary at that time. I paid it. Mom and Dad made me pay it. But I'd call up and I'd say, well, send the charges to, and I'd give them the number and call Nikki and talk for like 3 hours. Oh. Well, look what I got out of it. It was worth it. So what is a relationship? A relationship is what? A series of conversations. So what's it mean to go to heaven? What's it mean that you got to, you know, have an out of the body experience? No, it just means that we have. Here's the first thing that you got to do. And God, I'm talking to the men now. Just the men. Listen, you have got to ride the momentum of that men's conference. You can't do it just by coming to church. You've got to get yourself in heaven, men. Your wife needs it. Your children need it. You think, well, my life's so messed up. Listen, your life becomes crystal clear when you go to heaven and you hear and see in heaven, and then you look at earth. It makes perfect sense. Then there's no worry. There's no fear. None. Fear and worry evaporate in that moment of time. And what is this first step in heaven? What does it look like? It looks like a series of conversations. That means you just converse with God. But we're not done. Watch. The series of conversations then leads to a series of experiences. And you have these Holy Ghost experiences. You have a series of conversations which then creates a series of experiences. And these series of experiences, watch this now, they create a series of emotions. And the series of emotions create a series of memories. The conversation creates an experience which creates an emotion, and the memory will involve that emotion, and the most powerful memories that you remember in your life are called what? Emotional memories. You don't know what they said, but you'll always remember how they made you feel. The most accurate memories of your life are emotional memories, and God created that so that you could experience it in the secret place with Him. I'm talking about when you get in the presence of God and you're laying on your face like this and you're afraid to look up because you just figure if you look up, He's going to be there and you're going to die. And you curl up in a ball and you're weeping, not because you're sad, but because you're emptying out and being cleansed. And oh my God, He's in the room, and I can feel Him, and I can touch Him, and He's holding me. I feel like a child in His presence again. I feel like a child. And you come out of that. And at that moment, what you've done through a conversation has created an experience, elicited an emotion, and created a memory. And this is what I call a glory event. And then your life begins to cluster with these little glory events. Oh, hallelujah. Woo! You're getting happy. That's camp meeting 1997 right there. Whoa! Hallelujah. Your life just becomes a cluster of glory events. And then you'll start to understand what 2 Corinthians 3:18 means when he says we are changed into His image from glory to glory. That's walking in heaven. That's walking with the angels. That's hearing the secrets of God. That's the beauty of why we're saved. That's why we're here. There's a reason why God saves us and leaves us here. So we can bring heaven to earth. Don't ever be under the delusion that God's ultimate plan is to just save you so you can escape the world. Why are we so anxious to leave the world when Jesus is so anxious to return? He's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. He's coming back for His great coronation day. He's coming back for a wedding day, for a bride that understands, lift up your heads, O ye gates, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory will come in. And who is this King of glory? It says, the Lord strong and mighty. Who is the King of glory? I love this one. The Lord strong in battle. You got someone you got to fight with? Don't fight him. Let the King of glory, the King of battle. Lift up your head, O ye gates. Just let the King of glory come in. Develop it. Learn how to flow in it. I thank God for the men. Jeff, I thank God for our heritage. I think about your dad. I think about my dad. Jeff's mom and my dad were brother and sister. But you know what? I really thank God for our Grandpa Piper. Don't you have a vision of him sitting in Bond's Chapel, sitting over there to the left of the platform as you're facing it, singing those songs and just weeping and crying? Now, I want to tell you, my grandpas, they were godly men, and they were men. These aren't girly men. All right? These are men. Tough men. But they understood glory. Understood how to tap into a heavenly realm. Second thing that happens is heaven comes down. Before it comes out of your mouth, heaven's got to come through your heart. It's got to come through your heart. I want to tell you, there's a lot of intercessors and a lot of prophetic people that the target on you is your heart. And that's why intercessors and prophetic people get so offended. It's like they battle offense. They get their feelings hurt and then start having a hard heart. Here's why. You can still get to heaven with a hard heart, but you can't release heaven with a hard heart. And where people get fooled is, see, they got a hard heart and they got anger in their heart, unforgiveness in their heart. They've got feelings of resentment. They've been hurt. They've been rejected. They've been wounded. They got fear. They got all this junk in their heart. But here's what fools them is they still have like this access to heaven. They can still go there and they feel like they're okay. No, they're not okay, because God's intention is to get you to heaven is so he can get heaven down through you. And you'll lose your voice. You'll lose your language. You'll be like John. I'll be like Zechariah, John's father. He lost his voice. And it wasn't until he called John what God called him that he got his voice back. And the church will get her voice back when we start calling it what God calls it instead of what we think it is. He was in the presence of God, but he lost his voice. We got to keep our hearts pure. And how do we do that? I've been obsessed with this point for a number of months. Because the core message of the gospel was shown in the first salvo of gospel message, and it was John the Baptist. John the Baptist stood in the river, and he said, repent, confess your sins, be baptized. Those three things. Jesus preached the same message, and the apostles preached the same message, and they preached it in the book of Acts on the day of Pentecost. Repent, confess your sins, be baptized. I don't think we as Christians can move one inch away from that the rest of our life. If you get away from those three things, and here's what I'm going to talk about. When you get away from those three things, and you know, we think we're so smart and we got all this theology and we're going to get gold dust on our hands and we're going to heal the sick and we're going to get all prophetic words for the nations and we're going to travel, we're going to do... It all means nothing if we can't have the very core of these three things in our heart. When John said, repent, he was saying, buddy, you got to have an open mind. Religion wants to close your mind. Religion wants to tell you you're okay, you got it, you know enough. You got to keep an open mind. That means my mind's always open for revelation, always open for God to speak to me. When he said, confess your sins, he's talking about this word, honesty. I don't think everyone stood there and confessed every sin. That would take too long. How many people know it would take too long for you to confess all your sins? And plus, you can't remember most of them. Now, your wife can, but you can't. So you know what they're saying? They're just saying this. Dude, I got issues. You know what will keep you in your prayer closet? When you finally get a revelation, you still got issues. I don't care who you are. It'll keep you in your prayer closet. And when he said, be baptized, he was speaking to Jews. And here's the caveat about that whole message. Jews were never baptized. Gentiles were baptized in the Jewish faith. But if you were born a Jew, you didn't have to do that. And why did God pick baptism to be the message to Jews? Because God just wanted to see this. Are you humble enough to humble yourself to go to those baptism waters? Or are you going to stay there and say, no, I don't have to do that. I got Abraham. I ain't doing that. I mean, that is the challenge every time we have worship. Are you going to be open-minded? Or criticize people that dance around and do strange things with flags or fall on the floor or whatever? Are you open-minded enough for God to move on you and you obey God? You'll never get away from open-mindedness, honesty, and honesty. Are you going to get real or are you going to play games? Every Sunday, every day, you're going to get real, you're going to play games. Humble. Are you going to humble yourself before God or just stand back and say, I don't need to do that? And that's what the Pharisees did at the banks of the Jordan River. I don't have to do that. And remember what John's message to him was? He said, don't say to yourself, well, I have Abraham, because I'm telling you the axe is laid on the root. I don't have to do that. I ain't doing that. That's stupid. I ain't going down that muddy water. I don't have to do that. Why did the people go down in the muddy water? Because they had a different attitude. Their attitude was, dear God, if that helps, whatever it takes, I'm just miserable. This is why many of you have to reach a breaking point in your life before you actually break enough to get into heaven. I'm not talking about getting to heaven when you die. The blood of Jesus covers that. I'm saying to really tap into the kind of heaven that Jesus talked about that comes through a pure heart, open-minded and honesty, and then it is released in word. It's released in our language. It's released out of our mouth. As incredible as it seems, it is released when we praise. It's released when we declare in our prayer time. You can release heaven in your home and change the environment. When you tap in, purify your heart, and speak the language. That literally we change the atmosphere. I think when we're in here praising God, we're changing the atmosphere of this room. I really believe we're changing the atmosphere of our geography. I think that the praise of the saints is literally calling in angelic armies. I think the prayers of the saints and the praise of the saints is sending the Holy Spirit in greater power into the crack houses and into the drug dens and into the places where people are strung out and almost dead because of heroin. Your praise and the language that's coming out of your mouth is chasing down prodigals, running from God. That father that stood on the porch never said a negative thing about his son. He never said, his heart was so pure. I want you right now to stand, everybody in the room, just to stand. And I want you to call upon the name of the Lord. I want you to begin to speak heaven's language right now. I want you to think about Revelation chapter 4, where it said those 24 elders fell down and they just worshiped the Lamb of God. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory. You are holy, Lord. You are mighty. You are God Almighty. By you all things were created, and for your good pleasure they were created. God, we praise you. I want you to open up your mouth. I just want you to practice a little bit. You got to open your mouth. Don't think it. You got to open your mouth. Hallelujah. We praise you, God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Holy Ghost a little bit. Hallelujah. Oh. Hey, we praise you, God. Come on, even if it's just a sound, lift up a sound. Hey! Oh, into this environment. Hallelujah, bless you, Lord. Praise you, God. You are God Almighty. You are good. You are good. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. Holy is your name. We release this sound in this place today. The sound and the cry of your children. Oh, the sound of us singing with angels. Holy, holy, holy. We release this sound today. On this earth, let it be filled with the glory of God. Let this room be filled with your love and your presence, Lord God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. You are the Lamb. Worthy, worthy, worthy is the Lamb of God. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Worthy is the Lamb of God. You are God Almighty, Lord. You are God Almighty. You reign, you're in control. All things were created by you, and there was nothing created that you did not create, and you are in charge, Lord God. You are not nervous. There is no fear. There is no worry. There is no problems. Heaven! Oh, heaven, come down. Oh! We love you, God. We love you, God. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Ooh. Hey. Care what we look like, God. Let the world call us a fool. We don't care. Get down in the muddy water and baptize us, God. If that's what it takes, Lord, we're ready. If that's what it takes, Lord, we're willing. Oh, take us, God. We got issues. We got problems, God. Take us, Lord. Take us into the deep water, God. Let us wade in past our ankles. Oh, let us wade in past our knees. Oh, let us go to the deep, church. Let us go to the deep. Oh, woo! Take us deeper, Lord. Take us deeper, Lord. Let us see what we've never seen. Let us hear what we've never heard. Oh, let our eyes see what the Father does. Let our ears hear what the Father says. We speak life into Chillicothe. We speak life into Ross County. Life. Life, spirit and life into a drug culture. Spirit and life. want you to stay in heaven. I want you to stay in heaven today. My mom and dad used to sing a song that said, "Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole. My sins were washed away and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul." Hallelujah. I don't remember anything. About you. I'm not that old, Sandy. I don't just remember the chorus.
I have a hope that heaven's
a door. We'll get that. We'll sing that. We'll teach our worship team that. I want you to think about some of those old songs. You know, someone sat down and wrote that and just said, "Wow, heaven came down and glory, glory filled my soul. When at the cross, the Savior made me whole. My sins were just washed away and my night was turned to day. Oh, heaven came down and glory filled my soul." Now tonight at 5:30, Audrey Patton's going to be leading. She wasn't here today. She was leading Jackson. She'll be here tonight leading worship. Nikki's going to be preaching, bringing the word. I've asked Nikki to take the Sunday nights of November and just bring the word of God and bring the presence of God and bring the glory of God. That's not her. I'm talking to us now. The presence of God and the glory of God. I want you to come back tonight. We just need to have a glory event tonight. Amen. At 5:30, there's nothing better to do at 5:30 in the afternoon on Sunday than get in the house of God with other Christians. I promise you, those ball games aren't that exciting, okay? 5:30 tonight. I love you. Love every one of you. I would like to call on our healing team to make themselves available over here to the right of the stage. If there's anyone here that has a need for healing in your body, our healing team, they're going to avail themselves to pray for the sick. Right up here to my right. As we dismiss, you come forward if you need prayer in your body. Over here on this side, we have our prophetic team. And our prophetic team, they're going to be right here. Listen, they're going to be right here ready to pray for you and get you a word from God. They'll hear too. And it won't be scary, spooky. It won't be anything but encouraging, exalting, and comforting. So our prophetic team is going to meet over here. Anyone that wants prophetic ministry, when we dismiss, come over here. Anyone that wants healing ministry, come over here where John James is. And let these teams minister to you before you leave. And listen, if you don't know Christ here today, we didn't have a traditional invitation. But if you don't know Christ here today, you come forward and talk to me and we'll get some elders. We'll pray with you, okay? All right, I love you guys. Father, bless us from this place, but not from your presence. In fact, let us increase in walking in your presence. We love you, Lord, and thank you for the great services you've given us this morning. And we look with anticipation for the service tonight at 5:30. Lord, be with the saints today in Jesus' name. Amen. God love you.